Hey everybody, welcome back to the channel and welcome to the first place deck profile from Sorvent's non-meta tournament number 5. So this is Burning Abyss and it was played by Maticus. So unfortunately I couldn't get him on to record this with me just because he's a little bit busy with all the things that he's doing. So it's a little unfortunate. I did have an original like recording with him, but unfortunately the audio did get corrupted. So I have to do this by myself. So I think I know enough about this deck that I can kind of give an explanation for him, and if he's in the comment section below, I would appreciate it if he could also give some input on his list. But we'll go through it and basically go through everything. I know this has been a long time coming just because I've been a lot of busy with the Yu-Gi-Oh! On a Budget series, but I digress. Let's get into the list. So we have a copy of Seer and Graf. Obviously, I will mention that this is the non-meta tournament. Obviously, in the TCG, these are at 3 copies. But in the non-meta version, these are at 1 each for now. So yeah, and then Alec, Barbar, Calcab, and Rubik. So oh, and also Libic. So these are all just one ofs that he plays. So the thing with BA is that you mostly want to spread your names because their hand effects are all once per turn. And so the really interesting thing is that you don't want to really play 2 copies of a card, because if you happen to draw 2 copies, you're kind of stuck there. So the more consistent way to play BA is just spread your names as far out as possible. However, obviously, you want to play 3 of the really good ones, such as Farfa and Skarm. So these two are actually just like really important, being able to get your searches. Just being able to grind you is like basically the main idea, because like Farfa, being able to send this off of Beatrice on your opponent's turn or out of your hand off of Dynamiscus is really nice. Just being able to banish something on your opponent's turn. And you're going to want to do that continuously. You're not going to do that just like once or twice, right? So you want to play the 3 copies so you have access to it throughout the duel. So that is the idea behind the special summoning restriction and the effects of like the really good ones like Skarm. You're always going to want searches, you're always going to want interaction on your opponent. So yeah, Fiendish Rhino Warrior is basically like 3 more copies of all of the BAs, just because you can obviously send it from the, when it's sent to graveyard, you can send a fiend from your deck to the grave. So it's basically 3 more copies of everything. So it's just whatever you need access to. I think typically you just send Seer or Graf if you don't have access to them, or if you already have access into them, you send like a Skarm, or obviously if you're going second, you send of Farfa. So it's just like utility basically at that point. Tour Guide is really nice, since the really cool thing about it is that it does negate the effects of whatever you summon. So obviously if you summon a BA monster, it's negated and it won't be able to destroy itself, even though Tour Guide has a different name than doesn't have a BA name. Going on to Absolute King Backjack. So this is something that you usually play in this trap variant, where you send it to the graveyard either by linking it off for a Link Rebo or any other Link monster, or through like Dynamiscus, or even Fiend Griefing is usually what you send. But he has that in the side deck, and we'll get to that in a moment. But basically, there. It's just there to get like more interaction on your opponent's turn, just to set another trap card. The only bad thing about it is that it interacts with Skarm really rough, because if you send this on your turn, you can't really use its effect to stack. I mean, you don't really get a lot of value out of it, at least, because then your Skarm's going to search during the end phase and you shuffled your deck, so your backjack's kind of useless at that point. But a really cool thing that you can do with it is that you can stack a Farfa and backjack sends to the graveyard on the... instead of like looking at it, when you reveal the card, it goes to the graveyard or to your field if it's a trap card. So obviously if you reveal your Farfa, it's just going to go to graveyard, you're going to have a good interaction there. That also works with any of the BA monsters, but typically you just want to send like the Farfa. I guess you could do it with like Skarm or something, but yeah. He has 1 copy of BLS, which you can search off of the Chaos Space, which we'll get here to here in a moment. And we have the 2 copies of Effect Veiler. So you might notice here that he's playing a lot of dark monsters and only 2 Effect Veilers, which is his lights. So we'll get to that in the extra deck, but basically I'll just mention it right now. Dante and Beatrice are both light monsters, and you go into them very often. So those are usually the targets you're actually going to be banishing for your BLS. So You can banish the effect veiler, but these ones are actually most of the time the ones you want to banish, especially because he built this deck because Dante was limited in this format. And the really cool thing with Chaos Space is that you can actually, if you banish for your BLS, you can put your Dante back by using Chaos Space's effect to put the Dante back, and you get a draw. So it's really nice because you can recycle your Dante in a really interesting way. So I actually really liked his thought process on this, and I thought it was really cool. So shoutouts to him. That was like a really amazing, neat little trick to play around the limit of Dante. One copy of Foolish Burial, one copy of Monster Reborn. I don't think there's a lot to say about these. These are just good one-ofs. Two copies of Heavy Storm Duster. So he expected to play a lot of back row decks because obviously in a non-meta tournament, most of the decks are slower. And so they're going to rely heavier on like powerful trap cards such as like Torrential or Dynamiscus like he did. So he figured Heavy Storm Duster is actually like really good, just being able to blow them out during the end phase of their turn, which is like really good. It's really interesting to me that he ended up not playing a third one, not even in the side deck. He just opted just to play the two, which is a little bit strange to me, but I guess it worked out fine because he didn't really play against a whole lot of back row decks, so there wasn't really a whole reason for him to play these. And two copies of Ice Dragon's Prison. This is just an insane card. People have noticed that for a long time now. It's just, like, really good. Infinite Impermanence, just the one copy, obviously, since it's limited in this format. Makes sense. I mean, there's not really a whole lot to say about that. Three copies of Dynamiscus. This is really good because it can trigger all your BAs, similarly to Shadals. If you're playing Shadals, you know that Dynamiscus triggers all your Shadals as well. Same thing with Torrential Tribute. It can also trigger your BAs, and I think it's, like, really good. I don't think there's much to say about that either. Three copies of Trap Tricks. So this is just obviously three more copies of all of the traps that we previously mentioned, except for Impermanence, since you can't set that off of Trap Trick. Moving on into the extra deck, you have the one Purple Dante. Obviously, I think you have to play this because of Beatrice. So if Beatrice gets removed, you play your Purple Dante. It's pretty hard for a lot of people to out. So yeah, it's a pretty good card. The one copy of Dante. I don't think there's anything to say about this. Whatever this card is at in the format, you play it at. So if it's at 2, you play 2. If it's at 3, you play 3, etc. Well, the one copy of Leviere. So this can only summon level 4 lore monsters. I originally made the mistake of saying, oh yeah, you can bring back your Dante. Obviously you can't because Dante doesn't have a level. So yeah, but you can bring back any of your other BA monsters that you happen to banish. Typically you just banish them with like Chaos Space though. Then the one copy of Boralode, the one Cherubini, Gravity Controller, IP Mascarena, Nightmare Cerberus, Phoenix, Unicorn, Link Kree, Trisbana, Zeravoros, and a Triple Burst Dragon. I think that he mentioned that most of these cards didn't come up, the topologics didn't really come up. Although Zeravoros is like really good against Marine Cess, which is like pretty popular. At least like a decent option in the non-meta format, so this comes up, and they basically can't play if you make a Zeraboros on them, so that's pretty cool. I don't think there's anything else to mention about this. I think that his extra deck is, like, literally just perfect. I don't think there's, like, anything you really want to change. I think that it is very solid. Obviously, Gravity Controller is just to send the Dante. If you make it up in the extra monster zone, you can get some advantage off of that. There's some hands where you want to, but typically the board you make is like Beatrice Pass or like IP Beatrice. Those are like pretty often. There's not really a whole lot else that comes up very often. It's usually just the Beatrice Pass. And then set like three back rows. So yeah, moving on into the side deck, we have some pretty generic one of, so like Pankratops, Feather Duster, Lightning Storm, Mind Control, and the reboot over here. All of these are just pretty much like blowout cards going first or second. I mean, maybe with the exception of like Mind Control and like Pankratops, but these are like very similar in the way that you basically just take whatever threat your opponent has on their board. You can just take it or pop it in either situation. Three copies of Triple Tactics Talent. This is really good going first or second, depending on if you're against hand traps or breaking a board that has a lot of negates to it. So I think that this is definitely a really good choice on his part. And then obviously the three copies of Twin Twisters. I believe this also triggers all of your BA monsters, so I don't think there's anything to say about that. It's a really good card. Two copies of Fiend Griefing. So if you're playing against Paleo, you can go ahead and just like target the Ronin and put it back into their deck, and then send a Fiend type from your deck to grave. So you get a lot of advantage off of your usually send the like either the Skarm, or like you could send like a Farfa, or you could even send like a Backjack, which is really nice since get more advantage off of your trap cards. So like I mentioned earlier, so this is pretty good against like any sort of deck that relies super heavy on their graveyard, so that's really nice. And then two copies of Karmica is just an extra copy of Dynamiscus. It doesn't discard for, or does discard for cost rather than Dynamiscus. Dynamiscus doesn't discard for cost, so I think that's why he opted to play the Karmicas in the side deck rather than over the copies of Dynamiscus. So yeah, I don't think there's anything else to say about this deck. I think that it was a really good deck. He ended up getting first place, so there's not really a whole lot to say about that. If you do want to try this deck out for yourself, go ahead and join the link in the description below. Hopefully we'll be starting another non-meta tournament very soon. Anyways, with all of it said, thanks for watching, and we'll see you later.